Ever wondered why junk food tastes so good? Or why you can plough through an entire packet of crisps and still feel hungry? Or why you ate the entire jumbo share pack of peanut M&Ms while watching Frasier on Netflix last night? Let me ask you this. Ever wondered why obesity rates are climbing? You might be thinking that this rather obvious line of questioning is going to lead us to examine the relationship between junk food and obesity. Well, not quite. We've known for some time that the more fatty, sugary foods you eat, and the less you move, the fatter you get. But what if eating said fatty, sugary foods wasn't entirely of your own volition? What if you were addicted to junk food? Since the dawn of time, human habits have crossed over from convention to compulsion. Humans can become addicted to anything from pills to porn, from gambling to gaming. But food? Can we actually be addicted to something that we need to survive? There's mounting evidence to suggest that certain foods have the capacity to rewire the brain in the same way that drugs can. Several studies have found the brain's response to some foods can parallel its response to drugs, particularly when it comes to dopamine, a neurotransmitter that controls feelings of pleasure and reward. Scientists found overeating increases the level of dopamine in the brain in the same way drugs do with addicts. They also found that visually appealing foods rich in fat, salt, and sugar were more likely to affect this reward system, prompting you to eat more. And that's something that food companies not only know, but exploit. Author Michael Moss knows how far food companies go to keep you hooked.
So they have on staff or use consultants, people called bench chemists, whose job is to perfect, you know, the perfect amounts of salt and sugar, fat. And it is sort of a perfect amount. They can add too much.
He talks about famed food engineer Howard Moskowitz, tasked with creating a new flavor of Dr. Pepper.
Starts with no less than 59 different formulations of sweetness, each one just slightly different than the other, subjects those to 3,000 consumer taste tests around the country, puts the data in his computer, you know, and out comes these very precise charts. At the top, it's what Howard coined the term for, the bliss point, which is sweetness. Not too little, not too much, the perfect amount.
And then there's how the product feels in your mouth. Did you know that the more noise a corn chip makes when you bite it, the more likely you are to go back for more? I know how some chips melt the minute you put them in your mouth. You don't even have to chew. Well, that tricks your brain into thinking the calories have disappeared. So as far as your brain's concerned, you may as well be eating celery.
The connection to the reward center of the brain is really powerful. And the part of the brain that puts the brakes on overeating is very small and easily susceptible to even more shrinking. We're overwhelmed by hyper-engineered processed foods, and our physical system isn't sort of equipped to sort of deal with that.
Let's take sugar, for example. According to Moss, food companies develop enhancers that amplify the sweetness of sugar to 200 times its natural strength, keeping consumers craving the sweet stuff. The Australian Diabetes Council says the average Australian consumes more than 20 teaspoons of sugar each day. According to revised figures from the World Health Organization, the ideal amount is 6. The problem is, while this sweet stuff is delicious, it's also apparently addictive. In 2007, French researchers found rats almost unanimously preferred repeated doses of saccharin over repeated doses of cocaine. Other studies of overeaters have found that, as with drugs, the more highly palatable food people consumed, the more they needed to consume to satisfy those dopamine receptors. Food addiction is not clinically recognised, and there's no evidence of companies using specifically addictive substances in their products.
So if you're looking for that smoking gun, you're not going to find it. That's the genius of how the food industry keeps us eating. Everything they use is in plain sight, right under our noses.
And if there's going to be any change, it'll come from the person most valuable to the industry. You, the consumer.